Hello, 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 and welcome to another episode of Fix Your Plate with me, your host, Dr. Monique, the physician in the kitchen. I am so thankful to be with you again for another 30 minutes of talking about food, because you know, I could talk all day. So I'm glad to have some of your oh-so-precious time. I am Dr. Monique. I am a board-certified family physician who you know as the physician in the kitchen. Through my online cooking classes, my best-selling books, including my newest book, Doc Fix My Plate, The Physician in the Kitchen's Prescriptions for Your Healthy Meal Makeover, and my brand new online course, Veganish, How to Plant-Base Your Pantry, I help busy households just like yours enjoy healthy plant-based eating without impacting their hectic schedules. You know, this is one of the favorite parts of my week. I do a lot week in, week out, just like I'm sure all of you are listening to me. But this is my favorite part of the week. I'm so glad to be able just to kind of just talk and you know, share with you some of my passion for food and plant-based food in particular. So I'm just thankful for this opportunity. I want to continue our book club. We're doing a virtual book club. So if you've been listening, we have been reading from the book, Doc Fix My Plate, and we're doing Dr. Monique's favorite vegan food ABCs. So far we've done A through J. And so today we're going to do K, L, and M. So sit back, relax. If you have the book, you can read along. If you don't have the book, it's not too late. You can still order your autographed copy at docfixmyplatebook.com. But we're going to take a quick break, recognize our sponsors. We want to thank our sponsors, MDM Enterprises, LLC, and May Medical Consulting, PLLC. We're going to take a quick break, come back on the other side, and get into the alphabet according to Dr. Monique. See you on the other side.
If you want to educate, empower, and inspire our community, we're providing a wonderful opportunity for anyone who feels they can make a positive impact in the lives of others by applying to be an on-air radio personality. To set up an interview, call 877-342-7770. That's 877-342-7770 to apply. This is your chance to step out on faith. This is your chance to get the experience and education that you need in order to launch to the next level of greatness and make a significant difference. WDRB Media is now hiring on-air radio personalities. If this is you, no experience is required, no previous education needed. They do all the training. Call 877-342-7770 to set up your interview today.
All right, welcome back. If you are just joining us, welcome. If you were with us before the break, welcome to you as well. You are listening to Fix Your Plate with Dr. Monique. I am your host, the physician in the kitchen. And today we are continuing our walk through the culinary ABCs according to Dr. Monique. I am sharing with you my favorite vegan food ABCs. And if you've missed A through J, don't worry. You can always go back. My website, we have them. And you can go back and check those out. But at drmoniquemay.com. But today, we're going to get into K, L, and M. So K, any guesses what K may be? So K is for kale. Truth be told, people tend to be in one of two camps when it comes to kale. They either hate it or they love it. Fortunately for me, I'm in the latter camp. I actually enjoy kale. Kale is a member of the dark leafy green vegetable family. And because of that, it is ridiculously good for you and has tons of health benefits. It's also a wonderful ingredient in smoothies, soups, casseroles, salads, and, you know, kale chips. It can be used wherever you use collard greens or spinach. So if you're new to kale and you're looking for a new leafy green, think about incorporating kale. It comes in many different varieties as well. So there's something for kind of for everybody. There's the soft textured varieties like baby kale, which is what I use in my smoothies, and can be eaten raw because it's so tender. There are actually tougher varieties with like curly kale or like the dinosaur kale. You'll see it's kind of got like the kind of pebbly looking leaves. Those do tend to need to be cooked or at least marinated or massaged with oil to kind of break them down and make them a little more palatable. And you want to remove those tough stems in the middle. But there's really something for everyone as far as textures when it comes to kale. Kale is actually in the same family, we call it the cruciferous family, as broccoli, cabbage, Brussels sprouts, and cauliflower. So it's a dark leafy green, but it's actually in that family of veggies. It's got the essential minerals and vitamins such as iron, copper, magnesium, and calcium. So, you know, if it made this list, right, it's got to have health benefits. So I always like to share with you guys the health benefits in addition to why I chose the food and the recipe that I share as well. So as I was saying, it's loaded with the essential minerals and vitamins, including calcium, which, as you know, is good for your healthy, strong bones. And it's also full of fiber, because, of course, it is a vegetable and vegetables have fiber. No surprise there. Fiber, the benefit from fiber, if you remember what we've talked about before, it helps with a few things. It helps you feel full. So you what? Eat less, right? And it also keeps the digestion. It's good for those movements, helps to move things through the GI tract. And it also contains antioxidant vitamins, which you've heard me talk about time and time again, like vitamins A, vitamin C. And in fact, kale has more vitamin C than its leafy green cousins, the leafy green vegetables. So think about that. When you're looking for a lot of vitamin C, you can think about kale. And when you eat it in combination with foods that you're trying to boost the iron content, if you're trying to boost your iron content, if you couple kale with that, the vitamin C will help you absorb the iron. So keep that in mind too. But one cup of kale actually has more vitamin C than an orange. And it also contains a lot of vitamin K, which is important for people to take blood thinners. There's this particular blood thinner called warfarin or coumadin, because large amounts of kale and other leafy green vegetables can affect the blood thinning amount or the blood thinning effect of that medicine. We give that medicine to prevent blood clots in certain patients. So if you're eating a lot of these leafy green vegetables, you want to be sure to tell your doctor about that, because it can affect the blood level when your doctor tests for that, the effect of that medicine. Not to say you can't eat it at all, but you just want to make sure your doctor is aware of it. Because of, you know, it's a plant, it's got fiber, it has plant-based compounds that helps to decrease the risk of certain cancers. And the fiber is thought to help decrease the risk of colon cancer, right? So lots of benefits with kale. It also helps to lower your cholesterol level, which of course decreases the risk for stroke and heart attack. And it also contains a high level of beta carotene, which we tend to think of with orange fruits and vegetables, like squash, pumpkin, cantaloupe, things like that. But kale actually contains a high level of that. And the body converts that to vitamin A, which of course helps protect your eyes and decreases the risk for macular degeneration, which is a leading cause of blindness in this country. And it also helps with cataracts. And then lastly, it has vitamin C, like we've mentioned, because that helps with your immune system as well as your joints. So lots of benefits from kale. And it's versatile, right? You can actually saute it. You can bake it. You can, bake it as far as making chips with it. So variety of ways you can make it. And the kale chip recipe is pretty simple. You just rinse them off, pat them dry, toss them in a little bit of the olive oil, seasoning of choice. And, you know, simple salt and pepper, or you can do onion powder, garlic powder, you name it. Bake them at 250 for about 20 to 30 minutes. Check on them about halfway to make sure they're not getting too crisp or brown. And shake your pan and maybe rotate. If you have multiple pans, you want to rotate the pan so that they brown evenly. But do yourself a favor, and this is a lesson I learned the hard way. If you have a convection oven, be sure that the convection is not on, because convection is just a big fan and your kale chips are going to go flying everywhere. So take it from me. That's a rookie mistake that I made. And because sharing is caring, I am sharing with you because I care about you and those kale chips. And I don't want you to have to be chasing kale all around your oven. So do not use the convection setting when you are making your kale chips. Kale, as I said, I've used in multiple different ways, but in the book, it is featured in my kale, sausage, red potato, and cannellini bean soup. Just saying that makes me want to eat a bowl. This time of year, the weather is getting a little chilly. Soup is a great comfort food to have. So think about adding this one to your repertoire. As the name implies, it's got kale, it's got sausage, which of course is a plant-based sausage, red potatoes, and then those cannellini beans all mixed in together. It's a hearty soup. If you want to top it off with some, you know, if you want to do like a plant-based cheese on top or a piece of crusty bread, this is one for you to add. And the recipe is in the book. The smoked paprika also, I find that really tops it off. So if you want to really bring out those flavors even better, garnish it with a little smoked paprika before you serve it. So that's K. K is for kale. So we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back and get into the letter L. And this one is kind of, this is another one of those oldies but goodies, a food that I've learn to appreciate in new ways and experiment with and actually cook with more. So come back on the other side and find out what I'm talking about. Dr. Monique, and you're listening to Fix Your Plate. Thank you. We'll see you on the other side.
Calling all business owners, all independent artists, and all nonprofit organizations. If you are in need of radio advertising, we encourage you to call 877-342-7770. That's 877-342-7770. Through their Community Give Back Project, there is an entrepreneur foundation that is paying for free radio advertising. That's right, I said free, F-R-E-E, in support of our small business owners, independent artists, and nonprofit organizations. Please call 877-342-7770 in order to receive your free radio advertising today.
All right. Welcome back. You are listening to Fix Your Plate with your host, Dr. Monique, the physician in the kitchen. And we are doing a virtual book club. We're reading excerpts from my best-selling book, Doc Fix My Plate, the physician in the kitchen's prescriptions for your healthy meal makeover. And we're doing the alphabet part. So in case, let me kind of back up. So the book is a vegan or plant-based cookbook, but it's also got it's full of I call them, you know, nooks and crannies. It's full of other information to help you on your plant-based journey. And so in the back of the book, I do my vegan ABCs. And these are foods that I have come to appreciate on my own plant-based journey that I've been on now for just over 2 years. We've been taking excerpts from the book and we're doing the ABCs. And so today we're doing K, L, and M. So we've already done K for kale. And next is L for lentils. So lentils, as I mentioned, it's kind of an oldie but goodie, right? I've known about lentils, but they're a relatively newer discovery for me as far as actually starting to cook with them. I've eaten them like in restaurants. One of my favorite restaurants serves lentils. And their black lentils is one of my favorite things in a bowl. But I've just started recently cooking with them. And I can't tell you, this is like beans, right? If you go back and listen to me talking about beans, it's kind of like I was always intimidated to cook with beans. And I won't say that I was intimidated to cook with lentils, but I didn't appreciate them, right? I just thought I would see them in the store because they're right there near the beans. But they're kind of unassuming, right? You see them in the bag, you're like, yeah, what's the big deal with the lentils? Boy, was I wrong, okay? From a cost-effective perspective, from a taste perspective, from a nutrition perspective, this pantry staple really checks a lot of boxes. So let's talk a little bit about lentils. Now, just like beans, there are lots of different varieties. The more common ones are brown and black, but there's also red lentils, yellow lentils, green lentils. So the type of dish you're making is going to determine which one you use, because some of them, like brown and black, really hold their shape very well, whereas red and yellow get softer when they cook. And so those are might be better used as like a thickener in a soup versus something that you may want to retain its shape, like if you're going to use it, say, in a meatloaf or a burger replacement. So knowing what your final dish is going to be, what the texture you want, is going to determine which type of lentil that you use. Like I mentioned, black lentils hold their shape very well, so they're good in salads or meat replacements for brown and green lentils. And the red lentils or yellow lentils, which get softer when they are cooked, so they're going to be better for your curries, soups, stews. Think of them as a nice thickener. They're really a good way to add fiber and bulk to like a soup or a stew. So they're part of the legume family, which we've talked about before, and they really are powerhouses of nutritional value. And when we say legume family, that's the same family that contains peanuts, peas, things like that are part of the legume family. They're powerhouses of nutritional value. They contain zero fat and cholesterol, and they're very low in carbs. So for those of you on a low-carb diet, this is for you. They're packed with the B vitamins, magnesium, and potassium, and they're also rich in protein, which makes them a very good meat substitute. When I talked about beans, I talked about how reluctant I was to cook with beans because you have to soak them and all this other stuff. Lentils, you don't have to do that. It just keeps getting better, right? It just keeps getting better. A little bit of water, so, or seasoned stock. If you definitely want to amp up the flavor, use a seasoned stock or your homemade stock and some water. I'm sorry, some bay leaves, seasoning of your choice, and you've got the beginnings of a good time. Now, I want to go back because I want to give you a few more legumes, because I mentioned peas and peanuts. But so lentils are kind of what the first thing you think of, but split peas, soybeans, chickpeas, beans, dry beans, all of those are in the legume family. So just to close that loop there for you, since we are talking about L. When you're cooking with the lentils, though, you do want to inspect them because, again, they do come from the ground. So you want to make sure that you go through and you sift through, make sure there are no debris, no stones, because you would hate to bite down on a rock that's got, that you cooked by mistake. So please, please, please inspect your dry lentils just like you do your beans. And it's super simple. You place them in a pot of water or again, some stock. And the rule of thumb is about 2 to 3 cups of water for each cup of lentils. Your seasoning, a little bit of salt, bring them to a boil, bring them back down, let them simmer 15 to 20 minutes, depending on the type of legume or, excuse me, lentil that you're working with. And then if you want to kind of, shock them, stop the cooking process, rinse them off or put them, run them in the cold water, and that'll stop the cooking process. I've given you the good. Let me give you the bad. They can increase your risk for flatulence, right? Like beans, okay? So gradually increase your intake over time so that you don't have that unpleasant side effect. They are probably not ideal for people with irritable bowel syndrome. So definitely talk to your doctor first. If you start having symptoms after you eat lentils, definitely touch base with your doctor. And in those patients with irritable bowel syndrome, they can actually cause constipation. Just a word of caution there. So the recipe in the book that features lentils, I use them as a binder in my red rice, brown lentil, and mushroom burger. So I have to tell you, the inspiration for this recipe was I was in Atlanta and I spent, no exaggeration, $15 for a vegan burger at a fancy Atlanta hotel. It took one bite and the whole thing literally fell apart. I was like, what? So, you know, if I'm eating a burger, I expect it to be like a burger, a plant-based burger. It fell apart. So I was like, you know what? This is not cool. I'm going to see what I can make myself. So I whipped this recipe up in the lab, AKA my kitchen, and then I grilled it. So you got to get those beautiful grill marks, that smokiness from the grill, put it on the bun and topped it with my fixings, just like I would for a regular burger. Avocado slices replaced the mayo. So completely plant-based. And if you want to make it even carb friendlier, instead of the bun, do some lettuce wraps. It is delicious and it does not fall apart. So that recipe is in the book. So far we have talked about kale. We've talked about lentils. We're going to come back on the other side of this commercial break, talk about M, my favorite letter of the alphabet. I wonder why that is, but got something sweet in store for you. So come back, be sure, stick with us. Check it out on the other side of this commercial break. This is Dr. Monique, and you're listening to Fix Your Plate. We'll be right back.
God has placed in each of us a purpose. It's all a part of His perfect plan that while we are on this journey, we discover, develop, and birth the greatness within. In this book, you will find keys to how to discover the greatness within you and the reason it exists. Learn the seven stages of birthing the greatness within. To receive this best-selling book in exchange for a tax-deductible gift, call 877-342-7770. That's 877-342-7770.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us or coming back. If you were listening before, this is Dr. Monique. You're listening to Fix My Plate with Dr. Monique. So we are doing the alphabet. We're doing K for the letter K for kale, L for lentils. M is for maple syrup. So maple syrup, and this is nice, right? We've been talking about all this savory stuff. So now we're going to get into a little bit of sweet stuff here. So maple syrup is kind of my go-to sweetener for desserts. Now, do not leave this radio broadcast and say, well, Dr. Monique said that, you know, maple syrup is healthy. I can use it as much as I want and not have to worry about that. Because that's not what I'm saying at all. And if you say that about me, I'm going to find you and we're going to have a conversation. Maple syrup, like any sweetener, any dessert, should be eaten or used in moderation. Okay. If you're like me, I don't want to live in a world where I can't have dessert. You know, I can't do these diets where you cut out everything. Like I can't have any more of this or I can't any more of that. I can't do that. And I don't recommend people do that. But you do look for ways where you can save some calories or eat a little healthier while you're enjoying your food, your treats. I call it desserting responsibly or doing dessert responsibly, like drink responsibly, dessert responsibly. So I have started using maple syrup as my go-to sweetener because remember, if we're talking about just regular sugar, white sugar, that actually is not vegan because the reason it's white, it's been processed with bone char to give it the white color. So cane sugar, brown sugar, those are less processed. Those are plant-based or vegan, but white sugar is not. So if you're looking to go completely vegan, maple syrup is a good option for you because of course it comes from trees and there are a variety of, there are different grades of it. The darker, the lighter they are, they may affect the taste or the sweetness. But, and we're talking about real maple syrup, like not the imitation, which God knows what's in that. But we're talking about 100% pure maple syrup. And you'll know it because it is super expensive. It's not cheap. So you don't want to use the maple imitation maple syrup or maple flavored syrup because that is not what I'm referring to. Okay. Those are usually made with high fructose corn syrup, artificial flavors, and chemicals. And the difference between the two is going to be significant. So be sure you're looking at your labels. But like I said, that price tag If you're not paying attention to your labels, you will when you get to that register. So I use it in my baking. I use it in my tablespoon barbecue sauce recipe, which is also in the book. And as I mentioned, it does come in many grades. In the U.S. here, we have either grade A or grade B syrups, and then they can vary by color from light to medium to dark. Interestingly, the tree sap that is harvested later in the season is used to produce a darker color syrup and has a more robust maple flavor. So there are seasons to maple syrup. So go figure. It does contain sugar. So again, I'm not telling you to just go turn up a bottle of maple syrup and not have any worries. You do want to use it in moderation. It does have some beneficial nutrients, such as antioxidants. The darker syrups are higher in that than others. And it does have some minerals like zinc, calcium, and iron. And maple syrup has a lower glycemic index compared to table sugar. And the glycemic index is the number or the measure of how high your sugar goes up after you eat, your blood sugar. So how quickly and how high your sugar goes up after you eat a carbohydrate containing food. So the lower the number, the better. So for maple syrup, the GI or glycemic index is 54 compared to 65 for sugar. So a little less there. It does not contain any vitamins though, so keep that in mind. So if you're going to use maple syrup instead of sugar, just be aware that you're still eating sugar and do so in moderation. But I wouldn't consider maple syrup healthy. Okay. Just please hear when I say that. It may be less harmful overall, but diabetics, you still would want to monitor your sugars when you're using maple syrup. So I do use it. Because you can use less of it than you do with refined sugar. So the ratio there is about 2/3 cup of maple syrup for each cup of sugar. So that's good. And in the book, it's featured in my vegan and gluten-free sweet potato pound cake with maple orange glaze. Yum. So this is like a great dish for Thanksgiving or the holidays in the fall. The sweet potato, the maple, the orange, all those flavors just go together so, so well. And the way I describe this cake, my vegan and gluten-free sweet potato pound cake, is like if a sweet potato pie and a pound cake had a baby, it would be this cake. It's got notes of cinnamon and vanilla and nutmeg. And it really goes nicely with a cup of tea or a cup of coffee. And I will say that the recipe in the book is gluten-free. But remember, gluten-free just means the flour that I use does not have gluten. So if people who have gluten sensitivity or issues with their intestines, when they eat gluten, that's who that's for. If you don't have that, you can make this with whatever, you know, cake flour or regular flour you like to use. So that is my time. I told you guys I can go on and on and on and on and on, but we are going to end today with maple syrup. So that just means you got to tune in. So we're halfway through the alphabet. You got to tune in next week to hear what the rest of the alphabet tastes like as we go through my vegan food ABCs. It has been my absolute pleasure to be here with you today. As always, I wish you good food, good health. Invest in the rainbow. Invest in your health one plate at a time. Eat the rainbow and plant-based your pantry. If you want to learn more about how to set up your pantry, a plant-based in a plant-based manner, go over to plantbaseyourpantry.com. It's my brand new course that teaches you everything you want to know about how to plant-base your pantry. You can get your book, your autographed copy of my book at dogfixmyplatebook.com. And if you drop us a line, social media, Petition in the Kitchen, if you ask us a question, I will be sure to read it on the air, and you'll get a free autographed copy of my book. I got you covered. I've got you covered however you want it. So I am Dr. Monique. Be sure to tune in next week, same time, same place. And as always, I'm wishing you good health, good food, and be safe out there. Till next time.